Right, so yeah, hope you enjoy lunch. And we'll get started with our next presenters, Matt and Matt, from GEMS. So give them a warm welcome, please.
So, at first, Transport Canada said UAV unmanned aerial vehicle, but they officially settled on RPAS, which is a remotely piloted aircraft system. As you can see, they come in a variety of shapes, sizes, and different capabilities, but they all share the same commonality. They can be operated remotely from the ground with a controller. So, getting started. Kind of formulated this presentation on if your company or your project is looking at getting into a drone or getting into drone work programs. Few considerations. Number one, where are you going to be flying? Where are your job sites? What's your budget? Basically, where your job sites are will dictate the airspace above your job sites, and it'll tell you what you need in terms of licensing and permits, or what you don't need in terms of licensing and permits, and what kind of craft you can use in that airspace. So let's talk a little bit here about Canadian airspace here. It's broken up into this weird upside down cake shape. And for us, the airspace that we're kind of concerned with is Class G, for the most part. Ideally, you want to have a job site in Class G because there are really not a lot of restrictions at all. And then in the more urbanized areas, you got like your Class E, which is controlled airspace in smaller airports. For example, Buttonville would be Class E. Class C would be like Pearson International, Hamilton, heliports. Any hospital will have a one nautical mile radius for a heliport around it. That's Class C. And Class F is basically restricted airspace. It pertains to military airspace. If there's an air show, if there's training, parachute training, paragliding, these kind of airspaces are no-fly zone. And the link here, if you want to know where your job site is or what airspace or what restrictions are, this link up here will kind of give you a nice beautiful map and tell you where to fly and what the restrictions are and what you need. So I just pulled up this slide here from where we are. Here's beautiful Fenelon Falls, and you can see, and I didn't realize there was an airport around here, but a lot of the waterways will have seaports where they have a seaplane, which will be docked for search and rescue. It's kind of blurry there, but up here, when you go to the site, depending on your craft, if it's a sub 250 or above 250, you go to this controller here, and you enter what craft you're flying. Either it's a mini, you have a basic license, or you have an advanced license, and that'll change the colors and the restrictions of the airspace that you're flying. Anything in Class E or Class C, you can only operate with an advanced certification and with permission from NAV Canada. If you have a basic license, Class E and C are completely forbidden for you. So yeah, you can see here, it gives you all the information for the airports, what airport it would be. You can look it up under the Canadian Flight Supplement. It'll class, basic or advanced here, and I just gave you this warning, just saying that use caution in the area. There could be seaplanes, and it says if there are planes visible while you're operating, your flight is strongly discouraged, but not illegal. So just watch out for active planes. So practical uses for ESC. So when I'm doing my inspection, as you can see, and a lot of the time you're going to sites and it's not your site, you're covering somebody on vacation, you're taking over a site from somebody, they just kind of give you a drawing, you go there with a report, and you kind of hope for the best. And from the ground, you don't really see much, but once you get your drone in the air, everything kind of comes to life, and you can see it just looks exactly like the drawing. You can see your phone here, your inlet, you can see where your turbidity readings are going to be, you can see any creeks are going to be flowing nearby, you can see your low lying areas, you can see your accesses, your entrance points. So it tells you a lot just by getting a nice overview shot of the entire site. Same with this one here. The drawings kind of come to life. The road there, the ponds down here. It's a pretty basic site, but similar when the roads are built, when you have your just your ESC fence, you'll have your stage one earthworks, and you can see everything from this vantage point. So another good use, communication. Sometimes we'll do a report, we'll make items like this, and we'll say it's north of pond one or pond two. Well, pond one or pond two, there could be a lot of fence around it. There could be a lot of different areas where there's vegetated areas and eroded areas. And a lot of the times we'll get a contractor saying, yeah, I know, man, I got your report. I see this item. I have no idea where it is. Can you mark the drawing? Can you meet me on site? Can you come and show me what you want me to do or where this is? And back in the day, used to meet them on site, and I used to mark the drawings, and I used to do all that kind of stuff. Even when you do mark up a drawing, they can kind of see where it is, but then they have to go and look where the drawing pertains to the site. So I don't do that anymore. What I do is I just send them a photo with the area, and normally if you see, this is probably about 55, 70 meters here, you get a good overview of where this item is going to be. And this is a pretty big site. Even if you didn't have somebody who knew the site that well or knew where this was, you can always back it out, right? You can see the entire site. You show the exact area where it is. No names required. Here you go. I'll see you next inspection.
Make sure it's fixed.
Yeah, make sure it's fixed for the next one. So another one, just reconnaissance. A lot of times you pull up the site and this is what you see. It's a nice, beautiful mud map, by the way. These inspections sometimes were bi-weekly or monthly. We work for the town of Ennisfil. Sometimes these inspections are as required, whenever they want us to go out there. Time between these inspections could be months, right? A lot can happen in the construction season, as we know, within a month or two. And specifically with the town, they'll send me there, they won't know what's going on. They want me to find out for them. We have no communications with contractors or anything. So what do? I go there, and this is phase 10 of multi-phase development. Hectares and hectares of land. There's regulated area, there's regulated forest, there's everything. And you don't really see much from just like right here looking around. And you also don't want to spend 8 hours driving around, walking around 10 kilometers of ESC fence. So the first thing I do usually is when I get to a site that's unfamiliar or has changed, I throw the drone up and I take a 360 of the entire site. When you do that, you can see every single crew possible. You can see the fence guys off in the distance, you can see the earthworks guys, and it really helps you out. So for instance here, like I said before, you can't really see anything. This is where that was. From here, you can see they're importing fill. These trucks are coming in, which I saw. And then they're going all the way back here in this corner, in this valley, and they're filling. If I just walked in there like that and looked around, you think I'd be able to actually see that? So, and then from there, we can continue our investigation right to where we need to go. So there's your stockpile. I'm probably about 50 to 75 meters here. You can pretty much see everything. They're not as close to the fence line as I had thought when I was flying back here. So do I need to walk here? Not really. I can see there's no dirt anywhere near this fence line. And I already flew this in fast, so I know it's all installed correctly. So that just saved me whatever was there, half an hour to an hour. Here's another one, access. Like, how long realistically do you think it would take you to walk from point A to point B over there? That's about a kilometer. They just stripped all the topsoil and it just rained the day before. And you gotta walk here. Or you can walk here, but it's not gonna be fun either. And if you think this is an access, that's a riparian area, so you can do it in waders. But I'd like to avoid that. I'd like to avoid the ticks. I'd like to avoid getting my boots muddy, and I'd like to avoid getting the mud in my truck. So instead of spending all that time walking, you just fly in 3, 4, 5 minutes. So I just saved that amount of time coming up over here. And to add to that, I can see it's been a few weeks since I was at this inspection. They installed a pond here. So if I just walked in there and looked around, would I see that pond from here at ground level? There's no way. So now that I know there's a pond there, yeah, that's another turbidity reading that I have to include in the report. So it's good to know. Reconnaissance. Details. Like, you can, when I normally fly, it's usually about 75 meters, so you can add 4K with that phantom. That's pretty good for imagery. If I need to get closer to see the details, to see if they're putting a sediment trap in, to see if there's straw bales in between these fences here, I just drop my elevation. You're allowed to fly 30 meters horizontally from people with your basic license. With your advanced license, you can fly 5 meters. You can fly right up to these people and just take a picture of exactly what they're doing. Obviously, additional uses for drones, photogrammetry. A lot of the drones have centimeter level accuracy like that one there. So photogrammetry is, that unit there has multiple GPS modules in it, so it gives you very accurate global positioning XYZ with the craft. And then all we have to do is take ground control points, minimum 3 on a small site, we can go up to 5 or 6, to triangulate your location. You put the control points and your located photos into the software, and it automatically generates a map for you in 3D. And the maps are accurate to within a few centimeters, just as much as it would be if you were to send a survey crew out there. So doing this, when you build your base map, it builds a profile, and you can, from that map, you can calculate volumes, you can measure distances. You know, you can see, provide full earthworm mosaics. These are good for pre-construction surveys, post-construction surveys. You get a broad image on one photo, high res of the entire site. And there's software that they provide where you can program your flights prior to going out there. So all you have to do is start the drone, upload your program, and hit the launch button, and it does the exact same path every single time you're there. So for construction surveying and progress surveying, it's ideal. Here's some more stockpile volumes, cut and fill, removes the guesswork. I was talking to an individual earlier about contractors who have had the typical old school survey shots of a stockpile, and they kind of estimate the shape and the quantity and the calculations, and they give you estimates. And then they had another individual with a drone come in to do their volume survey for them. And because the accuracy was dead on with the drone survey, they actually ended up having more import than they were told by the CA. So that increased the cost of how much volume they brought in, right? So it was beneficial on their end to get exact quantities. So this is what I was talking about earlier, just baseline mapping, ortho mosaics. A lot of this will just be post-construction monitoring, long-term ecology monitoring for vegetation regrowth. Very useful for this. limitations. So batteries are going to be your biggest limitation. And as I was mentioning before, there's two categories of drones. There's a sub 250 and there's the above 250. The class of airspace and your budget obviously is going to determine what kind of drone you end up with. Anything sub 250, you're going to notice that you're going to only fly it in like nice ideal light wind conditions. The wind rating on a DJI Mini, it's gotten better. I think it's up to 30-35 kilometers per hour now. But with the fact that it has to be engineered to be sub 250, the motors are smaller, the battery is smaller, you get much less flight time. If you can afford it, the bigger motors, the bigger batteries will be able to resist the wind. You get more battery time and you get more flight time. You don't have to come back. Even though drones are useful, it is annoying if your battery runs out and you're 500 meters out and you have to come back and replace the battery. That is a loss of time. Another limitation, rain, which sucks because as an ESC inspector, you want to get out there for the rain events and to see everything flowing nicely. But unfortunately, most drones are not water resistant or waterproof. So you have to keep that in mind. You can't fly in any sort of mist or precipitation or snow at all. Even just the lightest thing, some of the moisture can get into the circuitry and cause short circuits. So other limitations, as I was mentioning before, no fly zones, your class of airspace. You can get away with flying remaining pretty much anywhere, but there are georeferenced maps within the Mini software that physically block you from entering forbidden airspace. You can fly in Class C, but it'll prevent you from flying within the inner circle, 1 nautical mile of an airport, Class C. It'll stop you dead in your tracks. There are other manufacturers who have no georeferencing, hint hint, Autel, where you can fly wherever you want and it won't limit you. Also, indoors, specialized equipment is going to be required indoors to protect the drone from hitting a wall, or if you're doing an inspection on the ceiling, you need a specialized cage around the drone so that you can get in those tight spots. Again, pilot certificate, it could be a limitation. With your Mini, you don't need a license. With anything above 250, you do. The licensing isn't that bad for a basic license. You can probably wing it with just a little bit of background reading, and it's pretty much an open book exam, so get away with Google and referencing for a basic exam. For the advanced pilot license, it's a lot more stringent, the passing requirements, and they give you a shorter amount of time, and the questions are borderline the similar questions that you would need to pass a flight school for a pilot's license. So you really have to know a lot of air law and navigation for your advanced license. Plus, once you pass your advanced license, you are required to do a flight test. So just because you do a test written, you still have to prove to an instructor that you know how to fly. And that test involves knowing your orientation. They try and trick you, you know. They say put the drone up in the air, spin it around, okay, go that way. Well, you're turned backwards now, so that control that made you go left is gonna be opposite now. So you really have to know your orientation, and you have to know how to fly a drone to do your flight test for advanced. Again, cost of entry, they're not cheap. That drone there in 2017 was like $3,000. Phantoms now with RTK, you're looking at around $10,000. Mini 3 Pro, you're looking at like $1,300, $1,400 for the Mini 3 Pro, and a Mavic, a decent Mavic now is like $2,500, $3,000. So there's definitely a cost limitation for sure. Word of advice, if you ever buy a DJI, please get the refresh package. So that's the, when you crash it, if anything happens, you get a full replacement for free within 2 years. We have taken advantage of that twice now. So get the refresh package. All right, so sliding into our next category here. So you discover now that you have to walk to point B here, a kilometer and a half before you mean? That's a lot of walking and still a lot of time wasting. Or do you need to walk there?
So in addition to drones, we wanted to touch upon some different instrumentation and equipment that GEMS uses and that's out of the market. So as Matt mentioned, this is going to be a far walk. Our inspectors, when we're on sites doing erosion sediment control inspections, we're often taking turbidity samples. If there's a nearby receiver, so there's a water course flowing by, we want to understand those turbidity readings upstream as well as downstream of that site to see if there's any impacts that the site's having on turbidity in that water course. If there's any stormwater management ponds or any areas where we're dewatering potentially, again, we want to take turbidity readings from those locations to understand the impacts that that's having. Kind of the common theme that we've heard through today in a couple of different presentations, or even going back to the initial slides that Brett was showing, after that 20 mil rain event, you saw that turbidity spike from 50 or 60 NTU up to 400 or 500 NTU, right? And that's someone that's on site, taking a sample, waiting 30 minutes, taking a sample, maybe spending a few hours on, say, taking that sample, okay? Instead of that, we have turbidity sensors and probes that can be installed and that have are connected to modems and our SIM cards. And that data is transmitted in real time to our dashboard. So instead of sending someone out there and sitting there and collecting those samples for the entire day, maybe every day, we've got some equipment that's going to be installed that has maybe a solar battery hookup. And we're collecting that data on a permanent basis if we want. Maybe we only need an hour. Okay, let's set it at an hour. With the equipment in the dashboard, we have the ability to set alarms. So going back to some of the Silt Smart applications where maybe 25 NTU above background is our limits, we can set those limits in the system to send notifications, alerts, alarms to the contractor, the consultant, the environmental inspector, whoever needs to be on that list, whoever needs to be on that call-out list. We can make it a proactive mitigation program. So implementing notices at 75% of that alarm so that maybe action can be taken before those limits are exceeded. So some of the different monitoring stations we have, again, using that telemetry and then sending all of that data directly to our dashboard. Just a couple of different examples. So, as I mentioned, multi-parameter water probe. So, if you're just looking for turbidity, we have just turbidity ones. You can add pH, DO, temperature, any parameter that can be measured in the probe will get hooked up and sent to the dashboard. Water levels. If you're measuring water levels in a well or in a hydrometer or in that stream, again, same thing, have it hooked up and get that data real time. Flow monitoring, whether it's an insertion flow monitor in a dewatering system, in a sewer, in a creek, any kind of application, again, hook it up to that, that communication box and you have that data in real time. So again, just a couple of different examples of some parameters that can be measured. As I mentioned, the turbidity. If you're looking for TSS, maybe sediment loading out of a stormwater management pond, maybe you have an ECA requirement from that, do a TSS and turbidity correlation. So take a bunch of your TSS samples at the same time as you're recording your turbidity, create that correlation, and then combine that with the real-time turbidity monitoring, maybe real-time flow monitoring. Now we can understand sediment loading coming into that pond into that natural receiver. So we pulled a couple examples of what turbidity monitoring might look like. So in this case, there is a low turbidity and a high turbidity. And so you'll see, which one's the one? So you'll see on this one, this is our low turbidity. So it hit that value of 50. And then that's where our high kind of turbidity range came in with the sensor. this case, we were monitoring the outfall during a stormwater management pond cleanout. And again, you can see where there's some active dewatering, that turbidity spiked. We were able to provide those alarms and those notices to the contractor, who then turned off the dewatering pumps, and then that turbidity went back down. So we were able to provide that feedback really in real time without having to be on site full time, and therefore a much more cost effective solution. This example is from a flow monitoring setup on a dewatering system. Again, a bunch of different examples here of your flow rate, total flow, so cumulative total flow gets measured automatically, pressure and vacuum in your dewatering system. It can also measure battery voltage or solar if we're relying on that temporary power solution for real time with those battery and solar setups in the field. A lot of times we don't have air to plug into, so that's what we're relying on here. A couple other examples. This one is air quality. So we're able to measure the particulate matter, PM 2.5 and 10, again in real time, as well as any other parameters, some VOCs, ozone, NO2, SO2. You can add on weather stations, so if you're looking at wind speed, wind direction, humidity, temperature, rainfall, if you want to add in rain gauge, you can add those weather stations on, and then again, get all that information in real time, which will help you when you're doing your ESC inspections to understand, hey, yeah, we just got 20 mils in an hour, we need to go out and do an inspection right away. Again, just an example of a deliverable and graph related to air quality monitoring for here particular particulate matter PM 2.5 and 10. And again, you can see kind of how it's being monitored over time. And again, actionable limits based on thresholds or limits in your contract that you need to implement mitigation. Could also be noise and vibration. So noise in particular, if you're generating a lot of noise through demolition or construction activities, we're worried about noise impacts to sensitive receptors in the community. You can set up noise monitors, again, to provide that real-time feedback. Vibration, if we're worried about foundations nearby for residential buildings, or maybe you're looking at protecting infrastructure, whether it's a water main or a gas main. You set up and install vibration monitors, and again, all that data is provided in real time. So tying it all together, by utilizing technology with drones and remote monitoring equipment, this has a lot of different advantages, right? You can reduce costs in the long run, depending on your project, by having less manpower on site, less time spent waiting around, walking around. You can have all that data in real time. For drones, it allows us to gain vantage points regardless of the terrain conditions. Remote monitoring stations give us another set of eyes on site. So again, by having it set at maybe 30 minutes or an hour, you're getting that data until it stops working, right? If you're out on site, you're collecting one data point. With real-time monitoring, you're getting data continuously and you can understand those trends a lot better. So cost per data point with your monitoring equipment is pennies on the dollar compared to labor-intensive data collection if you're looking at long-term monitoring projects. As I mentioned, you can understand trends, provide that proactive management and feedback to various stakeholders. Automatic reporting and alerts, right? So we set those alerts at 75% of the allowable trigger and of the trigger to provide contractors those notices. And then ultimately it's about making better decisions with better data, right? Instead of having just one data point a week, because that's the only time we're on site, now you're getting that data in real time, the entire time, the entire week. And we can make better decisions with that data. And then that's just an example of some of the different stations and geographically where we are on some of our dashboards.